That's who's there. Carried me back to old Virginia.
As part of Commemoration 2019's scheduled events taking place throughout Virginia this year, the Jamestown Settlement organized a special exhibit, Tenacity. Tenacity details the remarkable lives of the 56 women who arrived in the colony by 1621, the earliest African women, as well as the prominent Native women throughout Virginia. The exhibit highlights trials and hardships, but above all else, the exhibit shows how these women overcame those struggles and tenaciously endured. Tenacity is indeed a special exhibit. It is complete with a stunning array of 17th century artifacts and primary sources, such as the 1621 Farrar Papers on loan from the Master and Fellows of Magdalen College, Cambridge, and the 1625 Muster on loan from the National Archives of the United Kingdom. Here to discuss some of the women exhibited in Tenacity is Jamestown Settlement historian Nancy Egloff. It's a special treat to have Nancy on the podcast once again. She knows the Tenacity exhibit inside and out, as she was a major driving force behind its creation. Before we begin, Nancy asked me to point out that during our conversation, she had mentioned that the Powhatan chieftain descent was matrilineal. But in fact, descent passed down through the sisters of the Paramount chieftain, as John Smith noted in his General History. Do note this bit of information for the section in which we discuss the Powhatan women. I trust this discussion will pique your interest in the Jamestown Settlement's Tenacity. Do get your tickets before January 5th, 2020, or you'll miss out. Nancy, thank you again for meeting with me. I appreciate the chance to do a second interview with you. First interview was great. I really enjoyed it. And this time we're going to talk about another key pivotal moment in early Virginia history in the 1619 to 21 period with a larger influx of women coming into the colony. Now, these weren't the first women to be in Virginia. I know there's some misconception that these were the first women or women just started arriving at that period. But there were women here before then. Two names, as far as early Virginia history is concerned, with Mistress Forrest and Anne Burris Layden. Can you tell us about them?
Sure. Mistress Forrest came with her husband.
We don't know her first name.
Right. It was Thomas.
Thomas Forrest.
She came with her husband Thomas. I know there was a George, too, which is often confusing, and brought her 14-year-old maid Anne Burris. Her and
which fascinates me, a 14-year-old coming across the dangerous Atlantic at that time period.
And say some of the earliest women, we believe some of the earliest women prior to the teens came either with a husband or a father or as a maid, in this case, accompanying her mistress. I think Mistress Forrest herself was a tenacious woman to be the first English woman to say, I'm going to go for whatever reason, and then the maid gets tasked to tag along just because she's the maid.
Right.
So, but the poor maid, you know, gets here with her mistress, and as far as we know, Mistress Forrest probably dies because she disappears from the record, and two months later, Anne Burris marries John Layden in the first recorded English marriage. So she was freed, apparently, to marry, probably because her mistress passed away. Now she's the only sole English person at 14 in all of Virginia.
With a few hundred men in a bedraggled fort.
Correct. Probably. What a sight.
Right.
So another tenacious lady who will hang on for decades in the colony.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit more about her story. So she marries in the colony, and then she endures the starving time, and then she goes through martial law.
Yeah.
And in martial law, she doesn't have a great time of that, does she?
No, she and the court. If we didn't have things like court cases, we would not know a lot about these women if that hadn't showed up. But in a later court case, we know how Jane Wright and Anne Burris Layden were tasked with sewing shirts for men under the period of martial law when regulations were much stricter, and they were probably given pretty strict directions of how to do their shirts and how long the shirt should be. But apparently, according to the case, the thread they were given either ran out or was no good. So they made the decision to pull some of the thread out of the shirts they had already sewn and use it. And they were caught and they were whipped for this. And again, according to the court case, Anne Burris Layden was pregnant at the time and miscarried a child. She did have four daughters, though.
Already at that period.
Well, not already at that period, but by the time the records... By 1625, she had four daughters. She had given birth to four daughters. So this miscarriage would have been like at least a fifth child she had, but she lost the child. And then she made it through the 1622 Indian War and lived into the 30s or 40s, I believe. So
good long
really
time.
Really hung on.
Stayed married to John Layden the whole time?
Know, yes.
As far as we know,
mm-hmm,
sure.
Mm-hmm.
Wonder how John felt about his wife being whipped for sewing a shirt, not the way...
It wasn't recorded.
Yeah.
No,
I know how I would feel. brutal existence.
One of these two women just immediately disappears, and the other one stays in the records for a long time. It's really kind of ironic.
And she's the only woman for about a year, as you mentioned.
Yes,
1609
until the 1609 fleet of women and men arrive.
Can you tell us about some of those women? Some of those are pretty big names.
Some of those are pretty big names, and we know, you know, they end up in the records again.
Right,
that's how we
know
about them. So we have the family Pierce, William and Joan Pierce, and their daughter Joan, or Joanne, depending how you see it spelled. William was on the largest vessel of the fleet, the Sea Venture, which would wreck in Bermuda due to an Atlantic hurricane when the fleet was scattered. The women folk were put on a different ship, the Blessing, I believe. The Blessing of the nine ships was one of the seven that made it into Virginia in late summer.
Okay.
So mother and daughter get here. Father William is on the largest ship. You know, it seemed like a lot of the men who was anybody wanted to be on the Sea Venture. Everybody wanted to be on the big ship. So
very foolish planning there.
So the father doesn't know, you know, if his family has survived, and his wife and daughter don't know if he survived. Luckily, he's one of the ones who's able to get up to Virginia the following May, and the family is reunited. Pierce's feature heavily in the records by 1625 when they have a household in Jamestown, and they have one of the first African women who arrives here, Angela, working for them. So it's an interesting story.
A lot of connections there. Now, Joan or Joanne, she goes on and she's going to remarry, correct? Later on.
The mother?
Right.
I believe so.
So you've got two Joans there. You've got the mother and the daughter. The daughter, she features prominently later on in Virginia history. She marries into some major connections as well, doesn't she? Can you tell us about that?
She becomes the third wife of John Rolfe, the famous tobacco planter. John Rolfe having his first wife. Mm-hmm. John Rolfe and his first wife were on the Sea Venture, which wrecked in Bermuda. She was pregnant at the time and gave birth to their first child. And then she and the child probably died in Bermuda. So Rolfe gets to Virginia within a few years with this tobacco planting going on. He meets Pocahontas, the daughter of Powhatan, the paramount chief, and marries Pocahontas as his second wife. They travel to England. She dies in 1619 in England. No, 17. And Rolfe comes back and marries daughter Joan Pierce in Virginia. They have a child.
And then he passes, and she's
and she moves free to
marry
on.
Again.
Yes, these women just really can move. But you had asked about a couple of other tenacious women who came in 1609.
Sure.
One being Temperance Flower du Barrow, who came with her husband, a Mr. Barrow. We don't know anything about him except for that. Thomasina Causey came, I believe, with her husband Nathaniel in 1609. And these are women who continue on in the record. There are at least five, six or more that we know about who came in that large fleet of 09 and survived that awful winter, often called the starving time.
And Temperance Flowerdew, she marries into prominent positions there with George Yardley. And then there's the plantation that he names for her, Flowerdew 100.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned Causey. There's Causey's Care. I mean, so these are some of the earliest large landholdings in Virginia who are also going to figure into some of the other women on this list when we talk about some of the Africans and such, especially with George Yardley.
And some of these plantations have been excavated by the archaeologists, so we've got material culture coming out of Causey's Care, Flowerdew 100.
Okay. So then from there, we move into the next major period. I know there's a few women here and there. The records don't say a whole lot between 1610 and 1619 about women coming into Virginia. But we do have a group where the English are, what's the best word for it? They're, I hate to use the word corralling, but that's really what they're doing. They're corralling women.
Well, men and women from hospitals or prisons in where vagrant people are being placed, because vagrancy is a crime. So vagrants and thieves are placed in these various institutions, let's say. Mm-hmm. Bridewell being one that seemed to contain a lot of women.
Okay.
And so it behooved these institutions to empty their coffers periodically. It was kind of a win-win for both sides. They were ready to make space for new vagrants, and the Virginia Company needed workers for their newly formed tobacco field. John Rolfe, we spoke about him before, was planting the tobacco, and tobacco seemed to be taking off, so the company was planting tobacco on their company land.
Right.
And needed workers in the fields, and so these women who were known as strumpets, we would use other words probably, but they called them strumpets, were taken out of these institutions and brought over here to work in the tobacco field.
How do they settle, coming from the 17th century vagrancy background? How do they settle here in Virginia? Do they settle well? Do the men take to these women well?
The men didn't care for them because of their ill reputations. Yes, they didn't want that kind of... No, none of these men wanted to take that kind of woman as a wife.
Right.
They might not have minded having a liaison with them, but they didn't want to take them as a wife. And so when the Virginia Company started considering recruiting for women, for wives, the men said, please send us better quality women than those strumpets that you got out of Bridewell.
Right. So that's where the Virginia Company comes together. They start talking about what they're going to do next, and that's where they start looking for women. How do they attract women to come to the colony from a better station of life?
Right. They advertised in whatever fashion, broadsides probably.
That's
one of the major sources of main means of advertising in London. And women came from quite a variety of different backgrounds. Some of them had high connections to people, even closely related to the monarchy. One woman was a relative of the king's crossbow maker, it says in the document. Other women were daughters of farmers or tradespeople. But for whatever reason, either a woman showed some interest in coming, or her family thought it would be in their best interest and hers to send her.
Right.
They couldn't feed her, couldn't take care of her, needed to.
And the company promises they're going to clothe and outfit
and feed.
And take
care of these women, take care of them, especially until they're married.
Right.
So they make arrangements here in Virginia to have some married couples with whom the women are supposed to be staying until they make marriage liaisons once they're here. Those liaisons were not arranged ahead of time, although some histories will lead you to believe that. They were not arranged ahead of time.
Yeah, so they're meeting these men for the first time, they were always going to meet them for the first time, but they're meeting them for the first time and figuring out, can't really compare it to a dating situation, but I guess it's something like that. Who are you?
How that happened, If they had barn dance or what they did, we don't know how they met. And then there were some women we know who never did find someone to marry, which is kind of unbelievable considering that the male population was at least 6-1, always as high as 3-1.
So. In Tenacity, the exhibit here at Jamestown, or Jamestown Settlement, there is an exhibit about one of those women. Can you tell us about her?
Ann Jackson.
Yes.
Ann Jackson is featured in the exhibit because, we're able to track her because she still has her maiden name.
Right.
That's when women marry, it's very hard to figure out what happened to them. But Ann Jackson came as one of the, for our women, we can discuss the meaning of that, one of the 1621 women on the Marmaduke, and she was sent to Martin's Hundred. There were 12 women on the Marmaduke who were to be shipped to Martin's Hundred plantation. Anne had a brother there, John. So they arrive in late 1621, and in 1622, the Powhatan Indian chiefdom revolted against the incoming numbers of English settlers. Martin's Hundred was one plantation that was particularly hard hit. And we know that 19 women were kidnapped from Martin's Hundred by the Powhatan and taken to their various villages.
Right.
Some of the women were redeemed back by husbands who survived or other people almost immediately. But there are others like Anne Jackson who may have lived with the Powhatan for several years because she doesn't show up again until 1628, so 6 years later, in a case
right.
saying that she wanted to go back to England and her brother is ordered by the court to keep her safe until she can be shipped back. So mm-hmm. was she a victim of post-traumatic stress disorder, perhaps, you know, just couldn't handle life in
right.
Virginia anymore and wanted to leave?
So she's not all the women that came into Virginia married. She's one of them
that didn't. We know that because of her, you know, her name.
Right.
Is still
right. Now, you mentioned the Farrar women, the 56 that came over. Can you tell us a little bit more about them?
Sure, but I want to mention the Farrar. We call them the Farrar women because they show up in a large collection
yes.
of documents that were written and maintained by the Farrar family in England. And the Farrar men, in particular, and their wives, were well entrenched in the Virginia Company. The men were some mm-hmm. of the officials and so forth in the Virginia Company.
Nicholas
so they kept
and John.
A lot, yes,
yeah.
yeah. So mm-hmm. they kept a lot of business records and family records and maintained them. And they ended up ultimately at Magdalen College at Cambridge University and were studied by Dr. David Ransom quite heavily in years past. And he's published on them. And he located some of the documents in these papers that refer to these 1621 women. There are 57 women listed. One of those was a young daughter of one of
okay.
the other women. So 56 marriageable women. And the documents are so detailed and wonderful that they give the backgrounds of each of the women, their ages, which ship they sailed on, or five different ships, and any skills that they had that they could bring to a marriage and to the colony at large that they could embellish and, you know, assist in the colonial venture. So they're a wonderful wealth of information, and we loosely call them the Farrar women because they show up in these documents
right.
in this set of business and personal papers of the Farrar family.
And that's where we know the most about them,
mm-hmm.
other than when they get here and we know what they...
We know a little bit about them after they get here.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And they primarily, they come into Jamestown, and from there, as you mentioned, they're living with families until they get married.
Correct.
And when they get married, they spread throughout the colony.
And the colony at this point is the James River Valley and the
That's,
Eastern Shores. So.
Right. That's about it. Right. Plantations as far north as, well,
Ricus,
Flower 200
yeah.
and Ricus
mm-hmm.
and such, and then down to Kecoughtan and,
mm-hmm.
and Norfolk.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of rights would they have had when they came here?
They wouldn't have had any more rights than an English woman in England would have had, which is very minimal.
Right.
Unless you're a widow. I mean, if you're a widow in England, you can have a lot more rights. But in English culture, you are kind of at the whim of your husband or your father. So you have very few rights. We think that Virginia women might have had a bit more control over some of their estates. There were Virginia women who went into prenuptial agreements with spouses
right.
when they married so that they and their children could be cared for if the husband died. So there probably were a few more freedoms women had in Virginia than back in England. But for the most part, they're...
At least early
femme
on.
Covert. They're
right.
femme covert.
Femme covert.
They're under the cover, basically. Of a man,
mm-hmm.
a father or a husband.
What impact would they have on the colony? I mean, these women, they came into the colony and they had an enormous impact. Can you tell us about the impact that they did have?
Well, the purpose for sending them, for recruiting and sending them, was to create stability here so that men would have reasons to stay. That was the whole, it was part of a bigger scheme by the Virginia Company
right.
in 1618 under Sir Edwin Sands. Give the men an opportunity to perhaps start getting their own land. through a document called the Great Charter, establishing a general assembly to which people could select representatives and start making some of their own decisions and their own laws, and sending women who could start to create family life in the colony. So men would want to settle down on land, have a say in their legislature, and start to create families. These women came with lots of these skills, but for the most part, the reality of it is they probably were not able to employ too many of them, especially those that had the fancy needlework skills, because they were probably working in the tobacco fields with their husbands. Only free English men could take them to be wives. So either planters or tenant farmers, if they could come up with the 150 pounds of tobacco, leaf tobacco, that it costs to pay for the women's shipping costs. So it's going to be people who have a little bit of wherewithal, probably have a small bit of land, and they're going to be working with their husbands in these tobacco fields, probably until we start to see fewer indentured people coming to the colony and more Africans coming in about the second quarter and into the third quarter of the century. Then women will be freed up to do a bit more of the domestic kinds of activities that they were more familiar with back in England.
Right.
But for the most part, early on, they're going to be assisting their husbands.
Pretty hard
labor.
Right.
With their tobacco work. But that's a big impact right there, because a man
sure.
would need a support, either some servants, a wife and family, mm-hmm. sons, daughters. Yeah.
Companionship
so they,
as
they
well.
They do a companionship. Yeah. They do right. have a big impact. They were probably potentially doing things that, you know, they could be, start to be doing things that men would have had to have done mm-hmm. early on. A lot
sure.
of, as I said, a lot of the domestic work.
Now let's compare and contrast that a little bit. So the English, when they come here in 1607, the women they see at the time are the Powhatan women. What did they see when they see the Powhatan women compared to the English women? I mean, their society is different. It's women in Powhatan society have more power,
they
more
mm-hmm.
More authority.
They own
land,
things,
right?
They own houses. They, yes. Mm-hmm.
The succession of leaders is matrilineal, so it comes through
right.
comes through the wife.
Mm-hmm.
A major difference.
Well, it comes through the mothers.
Right, not the wife. That's right.
Wife.
That's right.
Yes.
I misspoke there, right.
Yeah.
So that shows them there's a strong importance here. One of those major women from the Powhatans, we all know about Pocahontas, or Matoka, Rebecca, the different names she had. But there's another major 17th century Powhatan woman. Actually, she's Pamunkey. Specifically with Kakakoweski. Can you tell us a little bit about her and her dealings with the Powhatans and as well as with the English, what we know about her?
Kakakoweski was the wife of Totopotamoy, I guess is how we would pronounce his name. Lots of syllables, Totopotamoy.
Right.
Who was king of the Pamunkey tribe. By the 1640s, not all of the 30 some original Powhatan tribal groups were still surviving. Some of them had
right.
shrunk, had been reduced, had combined with others. But the Pamunkey were one of the strongest, and Totopotamoy was the chief, and she was his wife. The Pamunkey, along with a couple of these other tribes, were tributary tribes to the English nation. So they paid a tribute to the colonial, English colonial government for protection from mm-hmm. marauding tribes from the north or from the west in particular. So they're a tributary tribe, and that's important. Totopotamoy assists the English in battles against
right.
incoming marauding tribes. In 1656, he is killed, and so Kakakoweski assumes control of the tribe. We don't know quite how she gained that, if she took it on herself and the elders agreed, but she becomes queen of the Pamunkey tribe,
mm-hmm.
which is a pretty big responsibility for this large tribal people. And she maintains the tribe for 20 years until the 1670s, when the English men who are at loose ends create a rebellion under their leader, Nathaniel Bacon, to rebel against Governor Berkeley and the English government. And that's the whole Bacon's Rebellion that
right.
erupts. Bacon wants a commission from the governor to go and attack these Indians on the frontier who are attacking English settlements on the frontier. And he does that. He doesn't get his commission. He just goes out and attacks anyway. And one
right.
of the groups he attacks are the Pamunkey.
Who were not a...
No-no.
Right. They weren't a rival tribe. They were
no,
friendly.
No, they were
right.
a tributary tribe. So that's a big no-no. But he attacks the Pamunkey. Kakakoweski and some of her people go into hiding. There are some deaths. Meanwhile, the government has taken her in to ask her to support them. And she said, why? She said, you haven't really redeemed me from the death of my husband when he was killed. So she's rather reluctant to be supportive, especially then Nathaniel Bacon's attacking her tribe. Anyway, the gist of it is that Coco Kowalski represents her tribe, and a couple of other tribal leaders come in to Middle Plantation and form a treaty. She wants peaceful relations, and she wants protection from the English government that this won't happen again. Mm-hmm. She wants protection for the people. She wants her lands protected. She wants to be the spokesperson over all these other native leaders. I think there are about four or five others. There are two different treaties of Middle Plantation, too, which is very confusing. But anyway, a group of Indian leaders sign this document with colonial leaders trying to establish these conditions. The lands will be secure. The peace will be secure. The tribes are supposed to continue to pay their tribute to the English government to ensure all of this. And so she signs along with her mixed race son, John West, that she had with Englishman John West. And she continues as the Pamunkey leader for 10 more years until she dies in 1686, I believe. So she was their queen for 30 years.
A very powerful one, one that had a huge impact for sure.
She was not able to maintain that control as spokeswoman over all the other tribes. They didn't grant her that. Grant her that ability. Nobody wanted her to speak for them. They all wanted to speak for themselves. So she was not able to reunite the former, part of her issue was to reunite some of the former Powhatan tribal people. That didn't happen in the way that she had hoped.
Got the English women coming in, they're helping establish essentially households and civilization for the English in Virginia. You see the influence of Powhatan women, like Coco Kowalski. We all know about Pocahontas. But there's a third group of women that also start to come into Virginia during this time, and these are African women. In the recent time, we've been hearing a lot more about Angelo. There's the dig going on over at historic Jamestown. Can you tell us a little bit about her and some of the African women also that are coming in at this time?
Mm-hmm. You probably have all heard already through Robert the story of Angelo's arrival on the Treasurer, one of the two English privateering vessels that attacked the Portuguese slaver, bringing these peoples actually on their way to Veracruz in New Spain. So Angelo, according to documents, arrives in the Treasurer along with 20-some others at the time, probably several on the Treasurer and the other 20 and odd, maybe 29 or so, on the White Lion.
Right.
Because by 1620, there were 32 people, African people living in the colony in that census. We are so fortunate at Jamestown Settlement this year that we've been able, as part of our Tenacity exhibition, to have procured on loan two wonderful documents that lay testimony to Angelo's presence in the colony. She is listed in both of these documents. One is a 1624 census taken in the colony, in which she's listed as Angelo and Igar. And the other document that we are able to show to visitors this year is the 1624-25 muster of the inhabitants of the colony, in which she's actually listed as working in the household of William Pierce with his wife Joan and in Jamestown, along with another of the English women, Esther Ettereef, who I believe arrived in 1620. She would have been one of those recruited women, and she was a servant in the Pierce household with Angelo. So in the 1625 census then, 1625 muster that we're showing, that we have on exhibit from the British National Archives, along with the 1624 census, Angelo is listed there. And she is one of the first Africans because of the fact that she's listed as coming in the Treasurer. And the Treasurer, as I said, was one of the vessels that brought those first Africans up to Virginia.
And Angelo settles into the Pierce household. But there's others as well, with Mary Johnson. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about Mary Johnson? She's got an interesting story.
Mary Johnson has an interesting story. There are other Africans, too, in the early records. We can't point to the fact that any of them, we don't know that any of them for certain came in that first group, because none of them have the detail that Angela's record has. But Mary Johnson arrived in 1623, because we know the ship upon which she came. So she was here by 1623. The next we know is that she's working at the Bennett Plantation on the south side of the James River.
Smithfield area, Suffolk, in that area.
That's correct, sure. Yeah. With an African man and some others, but a man named Antonio. And then by the 1640s, they show up in records again. We believe it is the same Mary and Antonio, now Anthony. They take the name Johnson, Mary and Anthony Johnson, who end up on Virginia's eastern shore, probably because of a connection with the Bennett family and the eastern shore. And they eventually have 250 acres of their own on which they are raising crops and livestock. They have several sons. Their sons amass another 650 acres. The family as a total has about 900 acres of land on the eastern shore. So they do quite well for themselves. They are freed. I should have mentioned that. The Johnsons are freed by the 40s to be able to acquire this land. And the records show that they had at least one African servant of their own and one probable slave of their own working for them, Kazar. There are a number of court cases in the Eastern Shore records involving the Johnson family and their various members. So we know quite a bit about them. Unfortunately, as the laws in Virginia became more restrictive for all races, but particularly Africans, they were kind of pushed out of the colony because of these restrictive laws, and the family moved north into Maryland by the end of the 17th century. Yeah.
So
it's a wonderful story.
It is. It's interesting. Some of these Africans that we see in the records before the 1650s, like the Johnsons, really the Johnsons are the main one we know about, but they're allowed to own land. Mm-hmm. They're allowed to be free and to become somewhat wealthy. I mean, 900 acres of land is pretty wealthy.
For the family, yes.
Right.
Uh-huh. Yeah, there are a lot of gray areas
right.
for this race in the colony in the early years. It's not so black and white, if I may say that, as it will be later on.
And then it does definitely change in the 1660s, and then officially after Bacon's Rebellion, and then into the 1690s, that changes. But early on, the incoming Africans settle on different plantations. Mm-hmm. They essentially learn the trade. Mm-hmm. I mean, they must have understood a lot of farming as well, from what they may have done in Angola,
sure.
where they were coming from, in southern Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So they become very key to a lot of these early plantations.
Mm-hmm. I think the fact that they had known how to plant tobacco in Dongo and Congo, from which they came, the early ones, to plant tobacco, that they were able then to be put right into this culture right away.
Well, the exhibit is Tenacity. Why did you guys choose the name Tenacity?
Oh, we went through a whole lots of different options for this exhibit, and we felt like Tenacity really stood for what these women have shown us, that the women we're featuring, women we know about, were all tenacious. They all hung on for one reason or another. They all survived.
Sure.
They all had some thing about them that kept them going, and they didn't give in. Even those that were impressed and brought into service, the Africans, some of the women out of the institutions in England, you know, they were impressed into service. They hung on. They survived. They fought. We only know about those that made it into the records, unfortunately. We know that the number of women in the colony was far less than the number of men to begin with, and then we know even fewer women, because they're the only ones who made it into the records.
Right.
They're the ones who were very tenacious.
Certainly, and their stories bear witness to that. Kako Koeski is the one who really captivates my mind, what she would have gone through. If you've been to Dragon Run Swamp, just knowing that she led her tribe into a very treacherous area to live, to escape Nathaniel Bacon, and then survive that, I think she's a great symbol of these women.
But I think Anne Burris as well.
Anne Burris as well.
You know, coming as
absolutely.
A young servant girl, easily given up, you know, being the only English female in that fort for that first year of her time in Virginia.
As a 15-year-old, or 14-year-old.
Hung on, and, you know, the whipping and the periods of starvation and Indian warfare and so forth. But all these women testify to that tenacious spirit.
Certainly. Amazing stories. And I think the exhibit is a fascinating exhibit. If you're in the Colonial Williamsburg, Jamestown area, certainly stop on by. There's things that you'll be able to see, like the Farrar papers, like the census, the 1620 census, that you're not going to be able to see again for a long period of time. We were mentioning how to preserve some of those papers, keeping them from light. So they're going to be hidden from light for the next 10 or even 27 years, I believe you said, for one of them. So now is the time to come and see them. It's a great exhibit, and I highly recommend you coming on by to see it. Nancy, thank you for your time.
You're welcome. I also wanted to put in a little plug for some of our programming associated with Tenacity. There's a lecture series. You can go online and check out our lecture series. Wonderful speakers coming over the year. Programming, we have an original play written by Abigail Schumann that will be performed in May called Mother Tongue, which three women who never were together in one place in reality, Pocahontas, Anne Burris, and Angelo, will come together and share their stories and their experiences. So that could be really interesting. And other programming weekends as well. So go on our website and check out all the interesting things happening this year here.
Certainly. And I'll put all of that information on the show notes page. So for those who are interested, everything is there. Definitely look for it for this episode. Again, Nancy, appreciate it. Enjoy meeting with you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Robert.
Thank you again for supporting the podcast. It's greatly appreciated. Please continue to spread the word and help this colony to keep growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and visit the website. Sharing episodes and other work is the best way to expand the community. Another great way to aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you have yet to do so, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Leaving those comments helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. It also helps me to know what I need to improve on in the future. If you would like to support the work financially, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPOD to see the choices and rewards being offered for your generosity. And please join me next time as we continue our walk through Virginia's history. Do 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 do